All right, here we go. Well, welcome everybody to our self-entitled Petrick Spinal Care class. I'm glad that you're on with me this evening. As I was just commenting, this webinar is in mute mode. In other words, you're not interacting with other people. It's just me. If you have a question about anything that I'm covering, just go ahead and shoot me an email. The purpose for this class is to help you get more out of your care. This is mainly new patients that are on this webinar. There might be a couple of long-time patients on here. But this is just a chance to share with you in more detail about what we do, why we do it, how we get results, but most importantly for you, how you can get more out of your care. As I already mentioned, this is not, there's not a raise your hand function, there's not a poke me or ping me function or interaction with other people. I suppose we could have a group activity, maybe the next webinar that I do. But this is just gonna be me and my slides. And I hope you get a lot out of it. And let's go ahead and get started. So I might have mentioned, but I've only been doing these Zoom webinars since this COVID thing started. And I've really only been doing it for a couple of months. I used to do live classes all the time, but it was kind of difficult for people to get there because they have work and then to wait to have their appointment with me. Other people are waiting and it's just kind of becomes a really big deal or too much of a deal, especially when we have YouTube videos and everything like that. But a lot of people are more open now to the Zoom webinars. So this is what we're doing. I'm not the most technologically savvy type person. This, I love flash drives. This isn't a flash drive. This is just something I grabbed. I don't even know what it is. I think it's a flashlight that's attached to my keychain. But, you know, I don't know about you, but I'm always losing. Well, not always. I am misplacing, and sometimes I find it difficult to find certain documents on my computer. I'll save it, and I want to put it on my desktop. I'll go through my desktop maybe once a month and just start putting stuff in files, but I gotta save it, I gotta put it on the desktop if I wanna work on it within the next couple of weeks. Because if I save it in my documents, I can't find it. OneDrive, Google Drive, Google Docs, where in the heck is it? So I love the flash drive. Now I've had this certain flash drive, it's a gray flash drive, and it's been faithful. I've had it for, 12 years. And it's all bent and it's hacked up and you move your laptop and the thing gets bent. Not one of these things, these are cool, but a real thumb drive, a real flash drive, the thing that you stick it into the computer and it gives you that good old fashioned doo-doo noise. I love that. And I love saving my documents on that because I got it there and I know that. I can conceptualize that. It's on that little flash drive. It's on that little disk. I can take it out. I can put it into a different computer. I can take it from work, I can bring it home, I love it. So there's this gray flash drive that I have sitting around home, and it's got a lot of stuff on there. And I popped it in the other day, and I wish I could show you some of the pictures. In fact, I actually am gonna show you some of the pictures. This first one here is Frederick. This is a couple of photos on that particular file. And Frederick, you got to understand, this is the first patient I ever had in San Diego, February 7th, 2005. And the reason that this is so special and so memorable is not only because this is the first patient I ever had in San Diego before I moved here from Minnesota. The O came out there. I was just talking to my mom a little bit ago. It's her fault. She's talking in a thick accent. But, and she's contagious. Frederick was my first patient I ever had, and it's one of the coolest stories that has ever happened in my office. Now, my office was on Miramar Road at this time, but Frederick was a Marine, and he got my business card because my office used to be on Miramar Road over there by the Ashley White Furniture Pyramid. It's 15 stoplights in from the I-15, right by the Denny's over there. And Frederick, he calls me and he comes hobbling in. And, you know, within a couple of weeks, he was one of these cases that just responded very, very well, very, very fast. Spine was resilient, takes really good care of himself. He actually threw out his lower back, not for doing anything with the Marines, okay, because he's coming over from the USMCS Marine base, which was just across the road, probably within 2 miles he lived of where my office was at the time. And anyways, he comes hobbling in there, and then eventually he's walking around like an upright human being within a couple of weeks. And he calls me one day, he says, Mr. Petrick. He always addresses me as if I was one of his drill sergeants. Mr. Petrick, I got to cancel all my appointments. I said, well, I don't understand. I thought you're doing so well. You're committed to the care. You're in this for maximal correction, healing, and stabilization. We already talked about this. I probably had him attend a live seminar like this. He says, you don't understand. He said, I'm deploying. I'm deploying to Iraq, and I finally passed my physical. I can go out with my dogs. He's in a bomb sniffing unit, and I can go out with my dogs. And so congratulations. That's, you know, that's why you're here, and more power to you, and give me a call when you get back into town. And so a year and a half actually passes by, and his hair is longer. He's got a mustache, hardly could recognize him. I hear this knock at the door. He had a glass storefront, kind of a retail type area back in those days. It's early in the morning. I'm dealing with my files. And I said, okay, I'm going to open the door, see what's going on. And it's a person holding a couple of special objects. Those objects are right when you walk into our office here in Rancho Bernardo, right by the water cooler. There's a shadow box. There's a picture of Frederick. And there is an American flag. And there is a poem in there. The poem is entitled, pretty shocking, it's entitled, Why We Fight to Die. And he said, Mr. Petrick, when he came back to me that day, he said, if it wasn't for you and your adjustments, I couldn't go and sniff out bombs with my dogs for the past year and a half in Iraq. So here's a flag that I flew for you, and here's a copy of the poem that I wrote. And I was, couldn't believe it. Like the coolest thing I ever received. It was spontaneous. It was patriotic. This is my first patient I ever had. He thought of me while he was over there, and he flew this flag and everything. So next time you're at our office, be sure to check that out. It's on the wall. It's kind of the story of my entire practice. Because what you're going to understand about yourself and about why people come to us is it's not because of their pain. It's because of their function. They're afraid that they may not be able to keep on doing what they're doing, or they haven't been able to do what they love to do. They're practically disillusioned or disassociated from themselves. They're disconnected, all right? Flash drive. And I know this isn't a flash drive, but I love this thing because information is on here. I know it's here. Gets lost if it's in the computer. So I love this. Okay? But there was something about him reconnecting or being connected to his purpose and why, his existence. Why was he in the Marines from North Carolina, I think he's originally from? Why did he go to Iraq? And the purpose is exactly spelled out in that poem. I don't have it memorized by heart, but it was something like it involves, am I over here to save an oppressed people from a depressed country? No. I do it for my God, for my family, and for my country. For that I would kill, and for that I would die. That's why I'm here in Iraq. That was part of the poem that he wrote. So pretty shocking. We're not called to lay our lives on the line in service for our country. More than likely, you who are on this webinar right now, I'm certainly not. But you do have a purpose. There is a higher calling. There is a reason beyond just pain or symptoms and why you're coming to see me and choosing to spend money and probably separate yourself from your family a couple hours out of the week or the month. And I just want you to know that I cherish that, and I thank you for your trust. And now it's time for the next slide. I thought it was time for the next slide. It looks like I'm firing a blank on this one. Okay, Here's a cool word, proactive. Proactive. Creating or controlling a situation by causing something to happen rather than responding to it after it has happened. Wow. Controlling a situation by causing something to happen. You know, that word control doesn't really have a positive meaning in our culture right now, does it? It really doesn't. Oh, he's so controlling. He's got to be in control. He's a control freak, right? But consider the alternative. If there were only three alternatives, which one would you choose? To be in control and to cause events to happen instead of respond and react to things after they happened or wonder what happened. To be in control in that sense, or to be out of control, that's not good, to be out of control. Or, worse yet, maybe, to be controlled. I don't like that. You know, there's only so much in our lives that we actually do have control over. And part of being proactive is realizing that, number one. Number two, doing something about it. And then I'd say number three is realizing that you have the power to act, to either do something about and to create a sequence of cause and effect, whether it's in your life, with your healthcare, with your spine, with what you do with your time, with your bucket list, with the fact that we're all on this planet for a certain amount of time, you know, sad to say it, you know, but there is an end date, right? There is an end time. There is an end zone. And our healthcare system, which is actually sick care, it's like the whole goal of life is to not die. Oh my gosh, so-and-so has whatever disease and it's terminal and they have this. You know, there was a time that it was about living. There was a time that it was about function. There was a time that people didn't actually, when they died, have to have a tag placed on their toe or have a certificate written about them and what caused their life to end. You know what I mean? But since there's that diagnosis, since there's that itis or ELJA, since our health care or health insurance, which is actually disease care or disease insurance, right? Life insurance doesn't do anything for while you're alive. It only works while you're dead. So health insurance actually only works really if you're really sick. But the problem with that, here's this again. Let's make this a little bolder, okay? The problem with this paradigm of health is this isn't healthcare, right? Things are a process. They want to separate us into groups. You're either a conspiracy theorist or you're a conformist. There's no room for thinking in the middle. That's what the media wants us to believe. There's plenty of room to think about things. I'm about power to the person, power to the individual, power to you. Thank you for being live with me right now. Or even watching this YouTube video after the fact. But let's get back to this example. Let's just say everything in life is a process, right? We are either going to the left or we're going to the right. We're getting smarter, or excuse me, we're getting less smart or we're getting smarter. We're getting more money we're making less money or we have more money. We're sicker somehow, or we're getting healthier. Everything's a process, right? My bank account, my checking accounts, I guarantee you it's not the exact same as it was this morning. There's pending transactions. All this stuff is in flux. So question yourself next, or question the person next time they say, it is what it is, because before you got to the second is, that original is may have changed already, right? Now there are principles, however. There are unchanging universal truths, and that's what I bank on. That's how we get our results. What we do is always going to work. It's always been true. It's always been based in truth. It doesn't change like shifting shadows. It's a lighthouse. Okay? If I drop this pen, it is going to fall. Gravity. We must align ourselves to gravity. We cannot break the law. We must conform to the law in order to have fulfillment, abundance, health, function, action, all these things. Okay, our healthcare system, you know this already, is based in trying to prevent something, or not even prevent something. Actually, it can really only possibly do this. So you can't put chemicals into somebody or take something out of them and do a surgery and actually create health. You might be able to prevent disease or treat disease, but you're not illuminating. You're treating the darkness. Now, we need to have medical care. We need to have crisis care, emergency services. But don't call that sliver of healthcare, healthcare in and of itself. So we have to be careful about things that we hear on the media, things that we might hear our family and friends say. I'm sure they're well-meaning, but you have to be proactive. You have to have the filter. You have to have awesome perception, and that's one reason why people come here and choose to get adjusted. Did you know that people think more clearly after they get adjusted? We'll unpack that here in the next few slides. All right, you've heard that the brain is like a computer. In fact, genetic cellular biologists, they're calling on the help of software engineers to help describe the phenomena that they're observing in the laboratory. They're using words like embedded gene networks, robust storage information systems, irreducible complexity, functional integration. That's how the brain works. It's incredible. And, you know, people say the brain is like a computer. Some people say it's actually as complex as the entire internet. And the thing that we have in common with a computer is, I'm just really, 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 really trying to simplify it. This is nothing, what did somebody say the other day? Kind of, it starts with an M, mystical or something like that. It has nothing to do with that. This is physics, okay? There's information, there's intelligence, there's organized intelligence that keeps everything somehow in harmony in nature. Pretty much everybody agrees with that. But there's also a distinct, separate, sovereign intelligence in each one of our, that controls and regulates and maintains our own cells in existence. It's the orchestrator. It's the conductor of the orchestra. Can you imagine if there was about 10, 12, 20 different instruments playing their own solos at the same time? That ain't going to sound good. It would be a horrible racket. So there has to be some information or some blueprint kind of controlling all of this. And how is that expressed? How is information, how is intelligence actually expressed? How do we know that something, that there's information or intelligence behind something? Well, it's called the design inference, and it's when we can recognize a predictable pattern, like chances are the next thing to happen is, you know, another tap on the table. Okay, so repetition. But it also involves a highly unlikely event, right? So, and a recognizable pattern, okay? So a cliff is an unlikely event. The ground was flat for a very long time, and then it just stopped. That's unlikely. Flat ground, 2,000 miles, and then there's somehow a cliff, all right? But when you have Mount Rushmore, now you have a highly recognizable, so, okay, again, computers and our own bodies, matter, intelligence, information, physical matter, DNA, your fingertips, right? A computer, that would be the I don't know, the mainframe, the hard drive, all the physical parts that you can actually touch, the hardware. Okay, none of this works unless you have force, unless you have transmission. In your body, that sovereign thing, information, that the intelligence behind all this is coming from the brain, of course. But you can't have any communication to the matter, to your legs, to your stomach, to your heart, to any of these things, unless you have force, unless you have transmission. So we'll connect the dots, and there you have a singular, sovereign, you know, entity, one person, in a way, it's simplified. This is what they are, kind of like a computer. Now, a computer is plugged into the wall. You're not plugged into the wall. Okay? It sounds kind of funny right now, but we might talk a little bit about that. All right? Thanks for being with me. Gosh, I'm going a little bit long today, so I'll kind of speed things up a little bit. All right? So all we do here is if there's a disconnect because the bone is on the nerve, it's not in the correct alignment, there's going to be a disconnect. All I do for a living is, boom, get that connected. How? Very carefully. Very, very gently, very, very specifically. Less is more, because your own body heals itself. It's not me. We just have to get in there and be very, very detailed. Pen, you know which key goes into the lock. You shouldn't have to try to jam it in there. That's why our upper neck-based adjustments, the main work that we do here, is very, very, very light and easy. Now, how does this all work? Well, accidents and injuries tear loose those connective tissues that hold the vertebrae together. This creates a weakness, and the spine can get stressed and locked into this position. One leg goes shorter, the hip goes lower, muscles are imbalanced, there's a lean to one side. It's a degenerative process, and this is understood to mainly occur at the top because structurally this is the weakest link, neurologically it's the most important, anatomically it's very unique, it's very unusual, it's very asymmetric. We cannot have any cookie cutter, hand-me-down adjustment methods. It has to be based on the individual in order to get the largest effect possible. We're going for one singular cause addressing multiple effects. Is this going to cure a person of everything that they have wrong with them? Of course not. Of course not. It is one thing. It is a structural issue creating a neurological consequence. And in this case, we're reversing the downward spiral and we're reconnecting it so that your body actually has a chance to heal. And that's how we get our results. Okay. So I said that we are not plugged into the wall like a computer is. We have circuit breakers. So what I want you to understand is that the misalignment, the problem that we deal with on a regular basis, is a problem itself. No question about it. It's progressive, it's degenerative, it's not good. However, it's also adaptive. It's also protective. A turtle going back into its shell is a good thing if he's about to get eaten by a predator. So when you experience too much stress, physical, chemical, mental, emotional, all at the same time, and you slowly go out of alignment, which electricians would call a slow blow of the circuit breaker versus a fast blow, like you have a major accident or injury or something like that, and then you're obviously out of alignment, you have an injury in your spine. Those are two different scenarios, but they're similar in that they cause the whole entire body to adapt and basically struggle and do anything that it can to keep the eyes parallel with the horizon, even if it's at the expense of you being in pain, of you having a very short leg or a rotated pelvis and all these other things that go along with the subluxation. All right, so here's our flash drive. In fact, this is so cool. I had to go and add another prong to that USB logo. The general USB thing has only three prongs, so we got an extra one here. So we talked about how when you are connected, these two little dots here, brainstem, cerebellum, the innervation is there, the wiring is there, okay? I'm gonna rip my wire out, here you go, my laptop's got a wire to it. But when it plugs into the wall, when you get adjusted, there's an activation, there's an integration in which a person is somehow thinking better, somehow moving better, somehow handling stress better, somehow secreting a more normal, more ideal chemistry, and therefore they're able to reset better while they're sleeping. All of these things happen when you get adjusted. Necessarily, the changes that we look for right after the adjustment, did you know that you have to go through that front door? In order to get to the living room, you had to go through that front door, right? In order to get to the kitchen, you had to go through the front door. In order to get to the rest bathroom, you had to go through the front door. This is the pathway. This is the gateway. It's the exact same neurological wiring that is integrated, okay? Functional integration. There's a computer term. Functional integration, this area, this certain area of the lower brain and the brainstem instantly at the speed of sound, better connected as a result of the adjustment. And then, you know what someone came along and did around the 1990s? They came around, they called it wellness. They took that which, this might sound arrogant, but that's okay. They took that which only upper cervical chiropractic could do as a singular thing. I'm not talking about vitamins and exercise and those things. Those are great. But simply know, this is for a different webinar, but if it wasn't for upper neck-based chiropractic, chiropractic wouldn't exist. Back in the early 1900s, the American Medical Association wanted to absorb chiropractic, call it chiropractics, just like they did with osteopathy, okay? Geriatrics and pediatrics, that's its own thing. They wanted to absorb chiropractic, maybe chiropractics, but BJ Palmer, entrepreneur, businessman, just guy wrote a ton of books, one of the fathers basically of chiropractic in the early 1900s, he said, no, we have to maintain our distinct identity, our science, our art, our philosophy, that is ours. We are not going to be absorbed into anything else. We want to stay in our lane. We want to stay in our lane. That's what we have to do. And that is what I am committed to doing. I do not do any, you know, a lot of chiropractic offices, they look like physical therapy suites. I'm not disrespecting them. I'm not throwing them under the bus. I'm sure there's a time and a place for that. And I've referred out to different chiropractors and physical therapists. However, I, here across the hall, I only want to do that which only I am licensed to do, which is very specific upper cervical neck-based chiropractic adjustments. Because of this reason right here, we want to get you better connected to yourself so that you can in turn connect better to the people that you care about most, and then you can perhaps contribute beyond yourself in a more meaningful way and have a more abundant life. That's what it's all about. Okay, next slide. Here we go. What does this look like in our office? Okay. Okay, I think I'm wearing the same shirt. I got a cool tie on though today, on that video on the left. All right, so that's not magic. Magic is my son over here. He made that quarter disappear. All right, but what we're doing is not magic. What does that imply? What does that imply, that I could touch a person down here and all of a sudden their leg lifts way better? It implies a lot of things. It implies what the research shows is that when you deal from up here and you unlock, that's actually more effective at increasing the pelvic range of motion than actually having a person down on their side, crossing their leg over and doing that to them really fast. So that is the best way to increase a person's range of motion. What else does it imply? It implies that the short leg on Erica in that example, that was a result, that was an effect, a consequence of a problem up top. It implies a lot of things, but it really implies that, here, let's just go ahead and play this video. it took me about 40 times to get that trick shot. Fortunately, I'm a better adjuster, and we usually get it on the first or second try. You know, if you've been here for a couple of weeks, sometimes I'll adjust you and then get you back up and have to keep on adjusting you until it gets into the right position for that time and place. But what it implies is that we're doing a lot of cool things neurologically. In fact, you've heard of the expression, two birds and one stone, three birds and one stone. There's 27 birds as a result of the NUCA upper cervical adjustment. But to me, that's kind of an eyeful. I just want to focus on this area right here, okay? That area that I was telling you about, the amygdala, the hippocampus, hypothalamus, vestibular nucleus, because that's how we get that, what many people would call the wellness experience. Thinking more clearly, having better energy, posture, mobility, not just playing defense, but actually offense as well. We're talking about creating health. I don't care if you're down here, if you're in the middle, or if you're already very functionally healthy, you don't have any symptoms or anything. If we find nerve interference, spinal imbalance, and we remove it, guess what? We are making you healthier. That's my goal. When a person is in our office, we believe that you're going in one direction, and we want to make sure that you're going in the right direction. Here's another depiction of that. Okay, you want to have a nice strong stool. You're only as strong as your weakest link. We're integrating this area here. When you get adjusted, over time, you hold your adjustments better. You become resilient. Okay, you can spring back. That's a beautiful word, resilient. How about resilient? Offense and defense at the same time. Tapping in direct proportion to your spine's resilience, the ability that you have to get well and stay well through upper cervical chiropractic care. Here's a Rocky clip. I'm not going to play that. I love Rocky. All right. So we want to make sure that you're going in the right direction. Got a few more slides here. One way, got to go in the right way. Okay. So let's talk about some spinal hygiene type things. I apologize. I'm going a little bit longer than a half hour, but probably about five more minutes. Okay. Don't just prevent stress. Create peace. On the weekends, at the stoplights, you can control your breathing. That's step number two. Energy breathing, right? Are your sinuses clear? These things are going to help you to hold your adjustments better. Number one, creating peace, preventing stress, breathing better. I had a great conversation with a couple of people about better oxygen flow. I mean, you got to breathe anyways. Why not breathe a little bit better in order to have better oxygen circulation to your tissues so that you can better hold your adjustments in the future? Number three, vital waters. You got to drink probably more water than you are drinking. And I confess, I got to drink more water. I try to make up for it on the weekends where it's more easy for me to break away and actually go to the restroom instead of having to cut away from patients all the time. But you got to be drinking enough water. If you want to be more alive than dead, eat foods that are more alive than dead. High energy nutrition. Movement and rest. If you're not resting very well at night, your air conditioning might be broken. But it also might be because you didn't get enough movement during the day. So you're tossing and turning because intuitively your body just wants to get that movement. All right. Conversely, if you're sleeping too much and maybe you're getting, I don't know, maybe you're getting too much movement, maybe you're, I don't know. What I do know is that there's a part in your brainstem that is mainly in charge of regulating your circadian rhythms, your sleep-wake cycle and everything. Number six, increase your fitness, okay? Not just so that you have the figure of the person on the front of the magazine cover when you're checking out with your bottle of water at Vons. I'm talking about what is your typical environment? Do you sit all day? I'm not saying not to sit all day. You gotta make a living. And that's how we make a living. We're scientists, we're engineers, and we're desk workers, and you sit there all day. Are you fit to sit, right? Do you have proper seating arrangement? Maybe you need a seating wedge. If you do, talk to me. I'll tell you about a product that we have which helps to actually improve your posture while you're sitting and while you're standing, yet also manually on your own with the help of gravity, affordably and effectively decompress your own spine while you're face down or face up. I'll tell you about that later. If you're interested, ask me about it. Okay. The keystone, keep this balance. That's going to maintain that archway over time. How awesome is upper cervical chiropractic? Well, let's unpack this. Let's reverse engineer this. And I want to share with you how if you're C1, if you don't make this primary, that your head is on straight, that the top of your neck is aligned, I want to demonstrate for you how these other six steps that you're probably sincerely doing right now to take care of yourself, and you've been doing that for a long time, how if this isn't correct, how you're not going to get as much out of these other things. And in some cases, especially when it comes to exercise, you could actually be making your spine worse. So let's break this down. Number one, we said create peace. How about this? If your spine is on your nerves, other people and other things get on your nerves more easily. Get your spine checked. If you're irritable, it might mean that you lost your adjustment. I had a person last week that said, yeah, I knew it was time to come in. I was just getting argumentative and I was easily irritable. I knew I had to get in here. All right. Number two, breathing properly. Did you know that you can breathe better when your spine isn't twisted like this and when your body is upright and open and you're tensegral, right? Attention, lightweight kind of structure instead of this brick building that doesn't move. A tensegral tension-based building like the San Francisco Golden Gate Bridge. There's tension in that bridge, right? It's flexible. That's what we want to be, and that's how you breathe better. Number three, drinking a lot of water, great. But if your spine's not moving very well because it doesn't have good alignment, you're not going to get good water into those discs, okay? The difference between an arthritic spine and a healthy spine is the healthy spine has good water content in the discs because the spine is flexing and extending. That's the only way it can get water into those discs is through passive sponge-like motion. And when your spine is in proper alignment, number one, then you can have proper centers of movement and therefore get better water into the discs. Number four, high energy nutrition. You want to be more alive than dead? Eat foods that are more alive than dead. And you also have to have good nerve supply to your stomach to actually get the most nutrients out of those foods. Number five, I already said that the brainstem is in charge of our sleep and wake cycles largely. Number six, when your spine is in correct alignment, you're going to get more out of your exercise. If you got a car that's not in very good alignment, you drive around the block a bunch of times, it's actually going to make the alignment worse. All right. So number seven, again, keep your spine balanced as number one, as primary, not alternative, not secondary to anything type healthcare. And you keep your priorities in order and you have a vision of what you want. We'll push you along and your vision pulls you along. You'll have the correct awareness. You know what you want. Okay. You have a better sense when you're in good alignment. Over time, you get a better sense of what actually normal is. So when the lights begin to dim, I know it. I knew it. I had to get back in here. I started waking up early again. I knew it. I had to get back in here because at 2 o'clock, I was feeling run down. I took coffee down and I still felt run down. I knew it was my spine. That's really the goal. When you start seeing things like that or when you start making those connections, then you're really, really, really beginning to get more out of your care. That's why we're having this class right now. I want you to understand that it's not just pain or no pain, in alignment or out of alignment. There's way more to it than that, okay? All right, your blender at home probably does more than just blend. Probably does a lot of other things too. All right, well, thank you very much for being on the webinar tonight. Just wanna remind you, Patient Appreciation Week is next week, and this is something we do once or twice a year. This time, we're giving away a TV and we're giving away four posture decompression system kits. That's kind of what I was alluding to before about sitting better and taller and standing. And again, if you want more information on that, let us know. But as it relates to Patient Appreciation Week, next week, August 17th to 20th, if you don't have your appointment set yet, what are you thinking? Get your appointment set, get your free visit. It's our privilege to be able to do that for you. We love it. Thank you for trusting us with your spinal health. And we want to help as many people as we can forward this flyer along to others. You probably got it in the email, or just call them and tell them or text it to them, and that would be okay as well. Well, if you have any questions at all about anything that we talked about in this class, or if you have any feedback for me, comments, you know, maybe don't go off on a tangent so much, or maybe try to cut out a couple of slides. If you have any feedback whatsoever, let me know. Again, thank you for being on the webinar with us. Next time you come to our office, check out that poem that Frederick wrote. It's right when you walk in. It's off to the right-hand side. Again, first patient ever. And it's kind of like the story of our practice. So thanks again for being on with us. You take care, be safe, be healthy, and I'll hopefully I'll see you next week at Patient Appreciation Week.